The 1920s were a time of man-taming Mother Nature. All over the United States, captains of industry were building modern marvels. The community of Yankton was no exception. The people of Yankton and the surrounding area had always wanted a bridge to Nebraska. And this time, they were going to get one.
The thing that makes this bridge across the Missouri River distinctive in comparison to any other bridge across the Missouri, at least in the state of South Dakota, and in many other places certainly, is it was built entirely with private money and without corporate money. I mean, except for local businesses, some of the banks or so on would maybe buy some shares. But it was something like 6,888 individuals, three quarters of whom were from Yankton or the immediate Yankton vicinity, who bought shares to make this bridge happen. And so there was no government money, no big corporate money. And maybe that's why it worked. They just said, everybody else has tried all these other ways, it hasn't worked. We want this bridge, we're gonna do it ourselves.
Kathy Groh and Lois Varvel have the same can-do attitude toward the book they are writing about the history of the Meridian Bridge. Construction of the bridge started in 1921, and work was done all year round providing jobs for area contractors.
We don't have a good number of how many people it took to construct the bridge, but it was clearly a huge project. I mean, we just don't realize how large this bridge is in comparison, for example, to the other Missouri River bridges in South Dakota. It is much larger than any of them, and because of its complexity, a big project. It was designed by Harrington Howard and Ash from Kansas City, Missouri, and then they bid out the various parts of the structure to major companies from throughout the Midwest.
The bridge was often referred to as the $1 million bridge. The actual cost was $1,169,367.17, which was quite a bargain for such an elaborate bridge. After completion in 1924, Yankton held a celebration that lasted 8 days and brought people from all over the Midwest to commemorate the dedication of the bridge.
The 1924 celebration would rival anything that contemporaries can think of in, for example, Yankton's Riverboat Days, which is a huge event now, brings 100,000 people to town. So did that. But that was 1924, and the Yankton community was considerably smaller at that time. And transportation was not as easily accessed as it is now. But to swell the town to 100,000 people in 1924, it involved things like a chartered train from Omaha that brought 1,000 people.
But how do you feed and house that many people over a week-long celebration in 1924 without restaurants or major motels?
The community had to provide those services. We know from our research that the American Legion provided a tent city. They rented out those tents to people who came as a place to stay. The church groups and civic groups and fraternal orders and so on provided food in their facilities, their church basements or the Masonic Temple or whatever. And for 50 cents you could buy a meal. I mean, they had to feed these people, they had to shelter them.
The entertainment also was a large undertaking. There were midways and carnivals with acrobats and air shows and fireworks the likes of which no one had ever seen. One reason the dedication was so grand was that this was not just the joining of two states, but the completion of a continental highway.
There were tremendous implications in the opening of the Meridian Bridge, not just for Yankton or even just our Nebraska neighbors, but for a very large part of three countries. This was literally the last link in the Meridian Highway, and that was a highway which stretched from Mexico City to Winnipeg, three nations.
The completion of the Meridian Bridge meant economic boom for communities on both sides of the river.
Every community up and down the highway expected they were going to experience a wonderful boom, a new growth cycle because of the accessibility of their community on this highway now. And of course, just like now, they jockeyed for the road to come ever closer to their community, or better yet, through the heart of their community, of course. And there was a great deal of competition in how the roads would be routed. And so they all were celebrating for what was to come as well as what had just been accomplished.
The structure of the Meridian Bridge is more complex than other bridges built in the same time period. The lift span was movable if needed to keep up with the changing channel of the river. The span itself weighed 800 tons, but was so well balanced it only required a 20 horsepower engine to lift the span for river traffic.
We do know that whenever it happened, it was a very big event, and there were always tourists. There were always people who were excited about hearing that the span was being lifted, and they rushed down to the foot of Walnut to watch that lift span being elevated.
Because the bridge was privately owned, it had to be maintained and paid for, so obviously it needed a toll.
The fare changed occasionally, evidently, but it opened with 50 cents per car and driver, and then 10 cents for each additional passenger.
The bridge company also tried to encourage railroad use on the bottom deck. Track was laid up to the bridge on the South Dakota side, and a grade was established on the Nebraska side. But as hard as the company promoted this, they never were able to interest a railroad company. This was only a minor setback, and the bridge was able to pay for itself through the use of tolls.
From the beginning, they were already putting out feelers to the state governments, to the federal government, to somebody to buy the bridge from them and make it free, and eventually succeeded. In 1946, the city of Yankton had a special election and quite overwhelmingly voted to buy the bridge. And it did indeed buy it as of December 31st, 1946, and managed to pay off the bonds and so on and make it free in 53.
Somewhere between 1946 and 1953, the notion that this could be free in 53 became sort of the rallying cry. And the effort to do that included, of course, the increased traffic that the construction of the Gavin's Point Dam brought. And we think it's safe to speculate that the free in 53 goal might not have been attained if the dam construction increased traffic had not occurred.
The 1924 and 1953 celebrations bring back fond memories of the Meridian Bridge. They are memories not just of the actual celebrations, but of other events, like taking your girl for a ride over the bridge, or lulling a colicky baby to sleep by the hum of your car tires as you drive over the bridge. These stories, and hundreds more like them, make the Meridian Bridge more than just a bridge. While the celebration in 1953 was elaborate and nothing compared to the one in 1924, both celebrations, for many people, bring back fond memories of a bridge to somewhere.